Belief is not important. What are those three? Craving for existence. Craving for survival. See how strong craving for existence. We are willing to massacre millions of others, destroy others for our survival. We can do any cruel, dangerous thing for our survival. We can destroy all the other living beings in this world for our living. Why do we want to do such things? Craving for existence. See how strong it is. Next one. Worse than that. Craving for pleasure. So we want to indulge, entertain all the five senses and the mind. So every minute we are thinking how to gain some sort of satisfaction, indulgence, or how to entertain our senses. To entertain our senses, we adopt certain method. We do something. And that something which we do to entertain our senses can be very dangerous, very unjustifiable, unreasonable, immoral, wicked thing. But we want to enjoy. Now it is happening. For our own satisfaction, we do certain things which create enormous suffering. Disturbances. Others had to suffer because of our craving for indulgence or pleasure. Now you can understand why we are facing so many problems in this world. These two things. We always complain there is no peace. In our mind, we have no peace because of these two cravings in our mind. The very day when we withdraw these two things from our mind, we never complain or no peace in our mind because there is no reason. Then there is another one. It is also intrinsic. Or natural craving. Even modern psychology also explains these three things. When you refer to Sigmund Freud, you can see libido and self-preservation and suicide instinct. Exactly same thing, but nearer to the Buddha, but not completed. Halfway. They have reached only halfway, but not completed. The Buddha has completed. Libido, more inclined toward the sexual side. They have discovered only that much. The Buddha says sensual pleasure, not only sexual, but among those pleasures, living beings can go mad when they were influenced or addicted. Sexual urge is stronger than any other forms of craving. Because of this, or to satisfy this, they can kill others. Now this is the danger of sexual urge. Psychologists take only this much as the strongest one. Then the next one, self-preservation, that means Buddha used the word craving for existence, craving for survival. We can do any wicked thing for our living. Whenever we ask, why do you want to do such bad things? Is it for our living? But it is not an excuse. Living for what? For what purpose? Now you want to live by disturbing others. Right. You can live by disturbing others. Then what is the purpose of your living? To disturb more and more people. That's all. There must be an aim in our life. Then the last one, psychologists say, suicide instinct. Buddhism says, vibhavatanna, craving that we maintain in our mind not to exist. There are many. Now you can see, I don't want to have another rebirth after my death. Having seen, experienced so many problems and difficulties in your life, you see, I don't like to have another life. This is more than enough. That is called suicide instinct. But your belief is wrong. You have not prepared to stop your rebirth. Just because you cannot satisfy with this life, you say, I don't like to have another life. Can you stop that? That is an illusion. Many others, it is due to their unsatisfied craving. When they could not gain what they wanted, decide to commit suicide, thinking that they can get rid of this problem. But they cannot think beyond that. That they are going to depart from this world with polluted mind, not with pure mind. If we die with polluted mind, our next existence cannot be a favorable state, can become a miserable one. We never realize this. So committing suicide is not the solution to get rid of our worries and problems. We invite more in the next existence. Now we can understand why we are suffering. It is due to our ignorance we always blame God or devils or some others, because we cannot understand, analyze who create all these problems. Created by our own craving. Craving for existence, craving for pleasure, especially these two. And Devaloka, they too have craving for existence. The formations of their life is such, they have no facilities to cultivate further and further, to accumulate more merit, to continue their life without facing shortcomings or disturbance. That is, they are weak. Now that is what these Christians try to convey. Animals have no chances because they are completely ignorant. They cannot mold their future life. Devas cannot add more and more merits into their way of life. That is the nature of their life. That is the very reason why the Buddha says human beings are more fortunate. by realizing this. While spending what we have earned, accumulated by doing some good deeds or merit, we are also going on accumulating. Spend and accumulate. Spend and accumulate every day. But others cannot do this. Others are going on spending, 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 spending everything what they have accumulated. After that, they do not know what will happen to them. And we have that mind to understand. Then, let me clarify this. Although they have spent the merit they have accumulated to be born as Deva, but in their storehouse of consciousness, there are so many other kinds of merits that they have accumulated earlier. Animals also have. Devas, ghosts, a spirit, Brahmas, human beings, say, wicked human beings who are committing sins throughout their lives. If there is anyone who can analyze their storehouse of consciousness, submerge, they cannot make use of them, eclipse through the other activity. By doing more and more bad things, they have not given a chance for their good karma to fulfill. So those devas, after their death, rebirth again take place due to one of the good karmas or bad karmas which were accumulated in their subconscious or the collective consciousness or the storehouse of consciousness. There is no guarantee whether they can go back to same Devaloka after their death. No guarantee. Whether they become human beings or animals, also no guarantee. It depends on the gravity or the degree of their karma, which accumulated in the subconscious mind. The Buddha, before he became a human being, in his previous birth, he was in one of these devalokas. He spent peaceful life after fulfilling all the perfections, virtues, good qualities and cultivations of his mind, everything is ready now. But he was waiting for the time. Time factor is very important. Buddhas never appear always. People are not ready to listen. When people's minds were intoxicated with worldly pleasures, they are not ready to listen to the Buddha. So Buddhas never appear during that period. Observe very carefully whether their minds are ready to listen. So he was waiting and watching. Then he had to become a human being in order to become a Buddha, because a god or deva cannot become a Buddha. There must be a human mind to cultivate. Since he had accumulated so much merits and cultivated his life, he had no difficulty, but many others, no guarantee. Then he asked, then how can they find out their ultimate aim or final goal? There are four stages for us to attain the way to Nibbana.